It has been quite a number of years since I built a content creating or video editing PC based on an Intel processor. While the blue team was still very competitive in gaming, there is little doubt that Team Red had simply given us a better value when it comes to content creation workloads. All that changed when Intel 12th Gen was launched. While some of us are still waiting for a new HEDT platform, at least now the blue bloods can lift their heads up high and show their double chin. In Intel CEO Pat Gelsinger's own words,
Alder Lake, all of a sudden, boom, we are back in the game. AMD in the rearview mirror and clients, and never again will they be in the windshield. We are just leading the market.
Walao eh. Today I'm gonna talk about everything you need to know to optimize your next 12th gen Intel build as a content creator or creative professional. Number one, how to choose the other components like your CPU, cooler, GPU, RAM, and PSU. And what are power limits and should you change them? And finally, do you actually need the i9-12900K or is the i7-12700K enough for you? Let's go fishing! Because we're at Alder Lake. So, you finally made up your mind about going Team Blue for your next content creating PC. There are some new tech being introduced with the launch of 12th gen Intel CPUs and the new Z690 chipset that you might not be familiar with. Like I said, let's address these important issues. Let us start with number one. How do you choose the other PC components? The number one important thing when building a 12th gen Intel content creator PC is to understand the cooling requirements. Now, I would recommend at least a decent 240mm AIO cooler for the i7-12700K and a 360mm AIO cooler for the i9-12900K. While the CPUs will output a lot less heat during gaming workloads, for content creators, especially during rendering, due to the new design where the CPUs can run at max turbo power for as long as their cooling requirements are met, then it is best to get the beefiest cooling option you can afford. Heck, there is going to be a genuine performance benefit of going for a full tower with a custom loop if you're using 12th gen Intel, especially for content creation and other creative workloads if you can swing the cash. Motherboard wise, you want something from any of the trusted brands with a solid VRM design to provide clean and reliable power to your CPU. Take the 18+1+1 phase power design on the MSI MPG Z690 Carbon Wi-Fi for example. Stability is a huge concern for content creators because we are constantly running the CPUs under heavy loads even if we are not overclocking. Other features that you'll probably want are plenty of USB ports for all your keyboards, color grading panels, Wacom tablets, external drives, licensed dongles if there's such a thing, and such. And of course, you also want good Wi-Fi and network connectivity. This motherboard natively supports the Intel Wi-Fi 6E and 2.5 gigabit Ethernet. If you use a Nest like mine that supports 10 gigabit Ethernet, then you could simply just add on a 10GBE PCIe expansion card, which is why I do recommend going full ATX for a motherboard if you're a content creator for those extra PCIe slots. Other than that, for GPU, RAM, and PSU, it's pretty much the same song across different platforms, except with a few new things. Starting with RAM, with the new Z690 chipset, we also get DDR5 RAM support, which gives us a huge upgrade in terms of capacity and speed. Unlike DDR4, where you could only go up to 128GB with 4 sticks of 32GB modules, with DDR5, you could actually get a single 128GB module, so the highest capacity you can actually fit into 4 slots is 512GB.
Voila! Need or not,
there's no such thing as overkill. Anyways, for 1080p video editing, you'd want at least 16GB of RAM. For 4K, I wouldn't go below 32GB. The thing is, with DDR5, it seems like the default option has now been shifted up to 32GB, with 2x16GB kits being the most common on the market right now. If you can afford it, 16GB would be better in case your video edits get a little more complicated with motion graphics, visual effects, and all that stuff. I would even go up to 128GB of RAM when 32GB RAM sticks become more available, since 6K and 8K capture is no doubt going to be more common even with mirrorless cameras in the next few years. But just make sure that you at least get a 2-stick combo for a dual channel configuration. RAM speed wise for DDR5 is actually quite limited right now. So I would say that for the 800 MHz and up will do. We'll definitely do more testing when faster DDR5 modules get released. When it comes to storage, the more the merrier. Just like with wives. I mean drives. Basically, you want a 512GB primary drive for your Windows and video editing applications. While a SATA SSD should be plenty, you can consider going with a M.2 NVMe drive for a tiny performance upgrade. Next, for your secondary drive, you want a 1-2TB drive for your project files. Again, a SATA SSD is more than enough for most people unless you work with high bitrate raw footage. Then you should probably go for a M.2 NVMe drive. And thirdly, you want a 512GB optional cache drive for your media cache and scratch files. For Premium Pro users, a SATA SSD will be enough, but if you're using After Effects with a lot of, you know, motion graphics and also visual effects stuff like that, going for an NVMe drive would generally be a better idea. Fourth and finally, we have the optional hard disk drive or HDD. For long-term storage where speed is not much of an issue, you can get a 4-6TB internal HDD these days for not much money. Really is a hashtag cheap buy. A few things to note here. Number one, feel free to stick to PCIe 3.0 NVMe drives if you want to save a couple of bucks, but I would at least go for PCIe 3x4 drives, which usually have a read-write speed of around 3000-3500 MB/s. You can also make do without the cache drive for the most part, since PCIe 4.0 is actually an overkill for most content creation needs. Unless you're a real pro lah, working with RE and RAID footage, then definitely add the cache drive, or you should definitely consider the HEDT platforms. As for the GPU or GPU or graphics card, you at least want to go for an RTX 3060 and up, but if you have an older RTX 2000 series GPU sitting around, that should work also. I prefer Nvidia GPUs for content creation, but Radeon, AMD Radeon GPUs will do the job just fine, especially when it comes to DaVinci Resolve, because that software is very inclusive that way and it's also free. For more info, please check out our GPU reviews. The thing is, you just need to make sure that you have at least 4GB of VRAM if you're editing in 1080p and 6GB of VRAM if you edit in 4K. Finally, we also have what? The PSU, the only U that you need. First rule of thumb is that you should not just get a sharp iron PSU, since stability of a PC for content creation is absolutely crucial, unless you want your P Pro to keep crashing for no reason. Next, how big should we go? Well, that depends primarily on your CPU and GPU combo, but in most cases, more so on your GPU. When paired with up to an RTX 3060, in my opinion, 650 watt is the bare minimum for the i7, and 750 watts is a bare minimum for the i9, as long as you get something with an 80 plus bronze or silver rating and up. However, for the sake of future proofing, in case you want to upgrade your GPU to something like this beefy MSI RTX 3080 Ti Supreme X, or add another card because some software like Resolve does benefit from multiple GPUs, or maybe you just want to add on an NVMe RAID card, I'd say at least go for an 850 watt PSU, or better yet, 1000 watt. Some very extra GPUs like this MSI one uses 3x 8-pin power connectors, so just make sure that your power supply unit supports that. Also, running your PSU close to the maximum limit will generate more heat, causing your PSU fans to just one fan to run at all time, which can be annoyingly noisy depending on the PSU model and fan. Also, going for a larger wattage PSU would allow you to run it in the silent mode when available, when your power draw falls below a certain threshold. And excessive heat can potentially lower the lifespan of your PSU, you know. For more info, feel free to check out our Your Mother No Teach Power Supply Unit edition. Moving on to question number two, what are power limits and should you mess with them? Conventionally, before 12th gen, say during the 11th gen Intel processors, when you run a heavier task, your CPU will start off at PL2 power limit 2, which is a much higher power limit than the standard rated TDP. A few seconds later, once this boosting headroom is exhausted, something they call Tau, I think. Go Tau? The processor will revert back to the lower default power limit, which is PL1. and will sustain that heat output until the work is done. With 12th gen, both PL1 and PL2 are set to the maximum turbo power. So basically, the CPU will run at 190W for the i7-12700K and 240W for the i9-12900K for as long as it doesn't hit the thermal limit of 105 degrees Celsius. Basically, power limit is kind of like the crown on Sun Wukong from Journey to the East, or Goku for Genso Maiden Sayuki. If you know, you know. If you take it off, you get unlimited power. But with great power comes greater cooling responsibility. Which is why, if you decided to go against my initial recommendations when it comes to cooler requirements, say for instance, if your butt itchy like this guy and want to build an ITX build with a 12th gen i7 or i9 processor, then you are going to want to lower your power limit a little bit, maybe. Setting a lower power limit could potentially be handy for three main reasons when it comes to a content creator PC. Number one, it keeps your temperature more manageable, which means that you can make do with a smaller cooler if you want to go for a smaller build, because not everybody has the budget or real estate for a giant bangsawan full tower. Number two, it lets you run your fans at a lower speed, which will make your entire PC quieter. Very important for those who need to record audio around their workstation, whether it be for voiceover or like a talking head video like this one for YouTube. Number three, and finally, it can extend the longevity of your CPU, because constantly running your CPU at higher temperatures, something that is unavoidable when you do content creation, this can lead to the premature degradation of your processor. But we don't know much about that because 12th gen is still quite new. Okay, but all that is only applicable if the performance loss from setting a lower power limit is acceptable versus the lower thermal output of your CPU. For that, we ran these benchmarks with the PL1 and PL2 firstly at default, which is both at the maximum thermal power. Then we set the PL1 only to the processor base power of 125W, which is the same for both processors, just to see if it would actually make a difference. Starting with synthetic benchmarks, in Cinebench, it seems that lowering PL1 to 125W only yielded a less than 1% difference. I was expecting to see at least a bigger difference for multi-threaded results, so I'm a little bit confused here. Moving on to productivity test, in Photoshop and Lightroom, again, we are not seeing much of a difference in the scores. That's to be expected since these are more single core heavy tasks. In After Effects, the PL1 adjustments seem to not really affect the i7 for the most part, but yielded 3% less performance in the i9. In Premiere Pro, we're seeing more of a performance difference with the lowered PL1. If you take a look at the smaller scores from the test result, you will see that lowering PL1 to 125W impacts specifically playback scores by quite a bit, not so much when exporting. In Resolve, we're seeing a 3.5% drop in performance in the i7 and about 6% of a drop in the i9 when you lower PL1 to 125W. Moving on to 3D, starting with V-Ray. Lowering PL1 on the i7 barely affected the scores, but it lowered the i9's performance by about 2%. Blender, however, tells a different story. We're seeing a 5 to 8% less performance on the i7 and about 14% less performance on the i9 when you lower the PL1 to 125W. This is the biggest performance dip that we've seen yet. Finally, the thing we are all waiting for. Temperature. Pay in mind for this test, we're using a massive 420mm AIO cooler. If your cooler is smaller or less effective, the temperature gains could be more significant. Overall, when running the CPUs in full load, lowering the PL1 to 125W yielded a 4% cooler temperature on the i7 and a whopping 10% temperature drop on the i9. I'd argue that for content creators, that's a huge incentive for you to lower your PL1. For 3D work, I'd just leave things at stock and get the largest cooler that you can afford or fit into your case. Finally, let's answer the biggest question of today. Do you actually need an i9-12900K or is the i7-12700K enough for you? Well, that very much depends on your workloads. from something like Linus. Specs-wise, the i9 and i7 have the same 8 performance cores, but the i9 has double the efficient cores, a faster max turbo frequency, as well as more cache. If your workload can benefit from any of those specs that I just mentioned, then you will definitely benefit from the upgrade. Based on our benchmarks, it seems like for content creation purposes, unless you're dealing with heavier 6K or 8K resolution files or raw footage, you'd be fine with the i7, so I'm talking about anything 4K and below. For 3D, it seems like the extra efficient E-cores in the i9 will definitely give you an advantage. Pay in mind that we are still at the very beginning of 12th gen Intel processors, so as developers start updating their software, finally, we might see some performance changes, probably improvements, with the new tech in the near future. As a side note, for gaming, if you had to choose, because you cannot afford both, an upgrade on the GPU over the CPU will always be the better idea and will yield you more performance for the most. And that's all, folks! It is good to find out that 12th gen Intel processors are actually a lot more power efficient than we thought during our initial review. Setting a lower power limit of 125W for the i7-12700K and maybe just a little bit more higher for the i9-12900K will yield you 93-97% of the same performance at a significantly lower temperature. This way, you can be fine with a smaller AIO if you want to go for a smaller build or if you want to just save a few bucks. But if you're dealing with 3D workloads, then definitely go big, full tower, 360mm, 420mm AIO cooler, or even custom loop, because the extra juice and cooling capacity will definitely help you squeeze more performance out of your processors since you already pay so much money. Just go all out lah. If you thought this video is awesome, don't forget to like and share and leave a comment down below, because we will try to answer to you in the comment section after this. And also don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the notification bell, and also follow us on Facebook and Instagram to see more shenanigans from the Mob House group. Also TikTok lah, because I want to tick your talk. And I will see you in the next one. For this week's comment section, we're gonna do a super throwback to our initial i9-12900K review, okay? And we're gonna start off, obviously, you know what? With the wonderful world of YouTube. Firstly, we have Hardware Sugar from the Philippines. What's up, bro? He said, damn, I'm jealous you got a hold of one of these. It's 2 months later now, and you should also be able to get a hold of one of these, because they should be everywhere, lah. Touch wood. Tessie Escobar, because he's the son of Pablo Escobar. He says, basically, Intel just overclocked their CPU for more performance, but cost extra power consumption. I actually thought this as well initially, but now after doing some power limit investigation, it's not so simple. But in this case, if you want to run it more efficiently, you should just set your power limit to be lower, like what we did in our test just now. Hu Mianjun says, wow, nice to see local creator review on launch date. Correct, because this is what? Malaysian representation. Ian Lee says, finally got competition. Exactly, this way us consumers only can win ma. No competition, monopolize already, how to win? Moving on to the I Give You Face book. Carl Warfel says, I need to wait for Intel i7 12th gen in Malaysian market. It is now very in the Malaysian market already. Raven Crossman says, dia nak buat ITX build, rasanya mesti panas kau-kau. Just follow our power limit guide just now. Set the PL1 to 125W and it will be sui-sui, bo zao sui. Elvin Gavieres says, this guy is very informative and helpful. I sent him a DM asking him some help and he responded. I will surely respond to you guys one. If you got any questions about PC, just PM me. I'm very friendly, you know. See my face, I don't bite. Rice C. Cruz says, for content creation, just get M1 proc. Yes, but you cannot game because you're not part of PCMR. And that's all, folks, and I will see you lah in the next one.